Linburg Comstock anomaly and median nerve neuropathy. Linburg and Comstock described in 1979 accessory tendon slips between FPL and FDP to the index finger. And this was in a cadaveric study, and in a clinical series of four patients, they felt that it was responsible for chronic tenosynovial proliferation around the flexor tendons just at the mouth of the carpal tunnel. Now, a number of different anomalies have been identified, including a shared muscle belly between FPL and FDP to the index, accessory tendon slips running between the two tendons, or just chronic tenosynovial proliferation encasing those tendons. It's not known why this anomaly exists. It may be that it's an evolutionary or developmental association between those two tendons that actually aids with precision grip and control of precision grip. But it equally well, particularly when it's involved with synovial proliferation, can be an acquired phenomena, and more on that later. A number of different papers have been written, one identifying the frequency of Linburg Comstock anomaly in musicians, thought perhaps to be due to differential glide between the FPL and the FDP to the index, particularly when playing woodwind instruments or stringed instruments. Chris Bainbridge has written on operative treatment of Linburg Comstock anomaly in a series of 11 patients, and it's even been implicated in failure of a FPL repair, and it was noted that in patients that have isolated FPL injury but also have a Linburg Comstock anomaly, that the index finger should be blocked to full extension to avoid excessive traction on the repair site. I've written also on the frequency of Linburg Comstock anomaly in normal population, and also described a simple diagnostic test for patients presenting with velar radial forearm pain using a local anesthetic injection to show that during differential glide between the two tendons, or effectively resisted extension of the index finger against a flexed thumb, how the pain can be diminished following a local anesthetic injection. A recent paper published this year in the American Journal of Hand Surgery has actually looked at the association between Linburg Comstock anomaly and median nerve symptoms. In it, it talks about median neuropathy, and whilst many patients with Linburg Comstock anomaly may also have idiopathic carpal tunnel syndrome, it's entirely possible that secondary carpal tunnel syndrome may have resulted from increased contents of the carpal canal due to the accessory tendon slips, or increased volume of contents due to the chronic tenosynovial thickening and proliferation, or perhaps even due to ischemia secondary to synovial encasement around the median nerve. What I'm going to talk about is what I believe should be termed dynamic carpal tunnel syndrome, or traction neuritis affecting the median nerve at the wrist. Now, there are many situations in which we use our hand where our thumb is flexed and then our index extends against this flexed thumb. And if there is a tendency or an anatomical variation where someone has a tether between the FPL and the FDP of the index, this may result in chronic synovial proliferation and inflammation, which can cause pain, but also can affect the median nerve. And the reason I say this is, looking at the anatomy here in the MRI on the left-hand side of the picture, just proximally about 2 inches from the origin of the transverse carpal ligament, the median nerve is deeper than at the wrist. And the median nerve lies in association with the FDP to the index and the FPL. And it's at this point that if there's an accessory tendon between the FPL and the FDP index, that differential glide can result in chronic inflammation, fibrous tissue laid down in the tenosynovium, a chronic inflammation, and encasement and tethering of the median nerve. And then differential glide, particularly movement of the FPL and the FDP during activity, can result in inflammation, edema, and ischemia, or traction of the median nerve. I firmly believe that this can be an explanation for why some patients who have failed carpal tunnel syndrome may actually have an underlying structural anomaly which has been missed. And I believe that in all cases of failed carpal tunnel syndrome, it's important to ascertain whether or not there is a symptomatic Linburg Comstock anomaly. Thank you very much.